This lecture is going to be about two-dimensional projectile motion, and the first thing we're going to do is define those two words. So for something to be two-dimensional, it means that it's happening on two perpendicular axes at the same time. A dimension is an axis of motion that you can move on, and that is at a 90-degree angle to other axes. So far we've been talking about motion that happens in just one dimension, that means back and forth along a straight line, but it's possible for motion to happen in two dimensions at the same time, where it's moving up and down and left and right. And it's also obviously possible for motion to happen in three dimensions, which is something that we'll talk about in future units. But for now we want to focus on two-dimensional motion specifically. And a projectile is any object with only the force of gravity acting on it in free fall. We talked about this a little bit in the acceleration unit when we talked about falling objects. So as long as this object is in the air, it's a projectile, and as long as the only force acting on it is gravity, it's a projectile. So two-dimensional projectile motion means movement of an object in both a horizontal and vertical direction where gravity is the only force present. As it turns out, this is a really important topic to understand in physics because a lot of objects in the world fit this description. So if we watch this ball being launched, you can see on my y-axis that it's moving up and down in the y-axis, and it's moving from left to right on the x-axis as well. So it's two-dimensional motion because it's moving along both axes. So the forces on a projectile are a little counterintuitive. If we draw the chart of the forces at different points, it's always only going to be the force of gravity. There's no other force acting on a projectile. Later on in this unit, we'll talk about forces of air resistance that can act on projectiles, but for most physics problems, we assume that air resistance is not there. So the only other force that can be acting on this projectile is the force of gravity. The reason why it's still able to move from left to right is because of Newton's first law. Newton's first law says that if there's no force on an axis, that means there's no change in velocity along that axis. So if this projectile starts with some x velocity, it's going to continue having that x velocity through the entire trip. So if it's moving to the right at 5 meters per second, it's going to continue to do that because there's no force in either direction to stop it. The acceleration of a projectile is always 9.81 straight down because, again, the only force acting on it is gravity, and gravity on Earth accelerates everything at 9.81 meters per second down. And the velocity of a projectile is the way that it's actually moving, the direction of its motion. We can break this into its x velocity and y velocity, how fast it's going in the x direction and how fast it's going in the y direction. And the x velocity is going to stay the same the whole time. If you're able to find a projectile's x velocity at any one point along its motion, you'll know that that's the same velocity for all other points along the projectile's motion because there's no force to speed it up or slow it down in that direction. So that means that the x velocity for a projectile is going to stay the same through the whole motion. The y velocity, however, is being changed because there's a downward acceleration of gravity. So for my example here, this particular projectile starts with a very positive upward velocity, but as it rises, it slows down in the upward direction because acceleration is taking away from it. It's being added to in the negative direction. At the very top of its motion, you may remember from the unit on acceleration, that there's no y velocity at the very top, because what's happening at the very top of its motion is that it's slowing to a stop and then beginning to fall again in the other direction. And then as it falls, it starts to get faster and faster in the negative direction because gravity is still accelerating it down. So these are the x and y velocities, and to understand what the overall velocity looks like, I just need to do vector addition by combining the tip of one vector to the tail of the other and then drawing that new connecting vector. And these are the resulting velocities at each point, which kind of fits our experience of a projectile. It starts going up at a large angle, but then slows until it's only moving perfectly horizontally and then begins to fall again. So this is what the velocity of a projectile tends to look like. Okay, this sentence is the fundamental idea of 2D projectile motion. This is kind of the guiding idea that we use to solve most of the problems in this unit. Kinematic variables on one axis are independent of kinematic variables on the other axis, except for time. We can use a separate set of kinematic variables for each axis to predict the object's motion along that axis. So if I look at what the object is doing along the y-axis versus what it's doing along the x-axis, there's no clear relationship there. Like it's moving up and then down along the y-axis, but it's only moving rightward along the x-axis. So these two things are independent of each other. So we can come up with two separate kinematic tables, one for the x-axis and one for the y-axis, where we find missing information about the object. So we're going to begin every single 2D projectile motion problem by making these tables for the x and y kinematic variables. And again, notice that time doesn't have a direction. It will be the only variable that is the same in both. These are some general rules for how to solve a 2D projectile motion problem. Because gravity is the only force on the object, the x direction acceleration will always be zero, and the y direction acceleration will always be 9.8 meters per second down. Whether you consider down to be positive or negative is going to depend on what you want to do in that particular problem. You just need to make sure that it is consistent with your other variables. The second thing to know is that you can only use kinematic equations on one table at a time. At no point can you put x-axis variables and y-axis variables together into a single kinematics equation. So you can only work with one table at a time in these problems. And time is the only variable that is the same in both, and if you don't have enough variables on one table, you should solve for time on the other table and bring it over to the table that's missing variables. You'll remember that you need at least three kinematics variables to use the kinematics equations, so if you only have two on one table and you don't have time, you can solve for time on the other table, bring it over, and solve some problems with it. I'll give you a few examples of that in just a moment. These are some code words for projectile motion. Launched horizontally or falls off a flat surface means that the object has no initial y velocity, or the y velocity is zero. The highest point in its motion, or the maximum height it reaches, is where the y velocity is equal to zero. So that means that if you're dealing with the highest point that an object reaches, that is the point where the final velocity of the object is 0 meters per second in the y direction, not in the x direction. The x direction stays the same, but in the y direction, it's zero. The range is the total x displacement of a projectile. And if the object lands at the same height it started with, its y displacement is going to be zero, because if it goes up and then down, it's at the same place where it started, so its total displacement is zero. Let's use these concepts to solve a few problems. A ball rolls off a 1.5 meter high table at 2 meters per second. How far away from the table will it land? So that's the ball's motion, and we're trying to figure out how far away from the table will it land. I'm going to call rightward my positive direction on my x-axis, and I'm going to call downward my positive direction in the y-axis. Just because this object isn't moving up at all, it's only falling down, so it'll be easier to call down positive. And I know that because there's no force in the x direction, the acceleration in the x direction is zero, and in the y direction it's 9.8. This is true for all 2D kinematics problems. And here I'm calling down positive, so that 9.8 in my y direction is positive. And the goal of the problem is to find how far away it is from the table, which is its x displacement. It's how far it's moved horizontally. Vertically, I can see that it's moving 1.5 meters, but horizontally, I don't know how far it moves. So that's the thing I'm trying to solve for. I can also see that in the x direction, it's moving at 2 meters per second perfectly horizontally. So that means that it has a horizontal x-axis velocity of 2 meters per second. And because that's pointing to the right, I'll call that positive and put that in the initial velocity. And in the y part, it's moving down at 1.5 meters of displacement. So because I'm calling down positive, I'm calling that 1.5 meters positive as well. And because it's moving in the perfectly horizontal direction to start off, that means that it's not moving up or down at all in the moment when it starts its projectile motion. So if it's not moving up or down at all to start off, that means that its initial y velocity is going to be zero. That's all the information that we can get from the beginning of this projectile problem. Most of the challenge of solving projectile motion problems really comes from having to read out that information and understand what it's telling you. After you do that, the rest is pretty straightforward. You just look for what you're trying to look for, and I can see that I'm trying to find the displacement in the x direction, and I can see that I only have two other variables in the x direction, so I don't have enough in that table to solve for the displacement. So what I can do is try to solve for time on the y-axis table and then bring time over, because the time that it falls is going to be equal to the time that it's in the air in the x direction as well. So looking at my y table, I see I have s, u, a, and I need t, and the only thing that connects those is this second kinematics equation. So when I plug in my numbers, I get t by itself is equal to 0.56 seconds. So that's the total time that it's in the air before it falls the full 1.5 meters, so that means that it's also the time that it's in the air in the x direction. So I can take that over into the x table, and now I can solve for the displacement. And I can see I have s, u, a, and t, so I'm actually going to use that same equation, but this time I'm solving for s. And when I do that, I get 1.12 meters. So that means that if you launch a ball off a 1.5 meter table at 2 meters per second and there's no air resistance, it will go exactly 1.12 meters away from the table. This is example number 2. A ball is launched at 10 meters per second at a 30 degree angle above the horizontal. How far away will it land? So this is the motion of the ball, and we're trying to figure out how far away it lands. I'm going to call the rightward direction in the x-axis positive and the upward direction in the y-axis positive. You can choose which directions are positive and negative on your own, that's okay, as long as they're consistent. Just like with all 2D projectile problems, I know that the acceleration in the x direction is zero and the acceleration in the y direction is 9.8 down, which because up is positive here, I'm going to have to call down negative, so that acceleration is negative. That's going to be really important for solving these problems. And I can see that I have a problem where the initial velocity isn't in the x direction or the y direction, it's in both. It's moving both horizontally and vertically at the same time. So to figure out how fast it's going in the x direction and y direction, I can find the x component and y component of that that velocity using trig. One more thing I can see is that the total displacement in the y direction is 0 meters because it's going up but then falling back down to its original position. So it didn't actually move in total in the up-down direction from the place where it started. So its total displacement in the y direction is 0. Solving for those initial velocities in the x and y direction using trig gets me these answers. In the x direction, it's 8.7 meters per second, and in the y direction, it's 5 meters per second up, which is positive. And if I'm trying to figure out how far away it will land, I need to find the displacement in the x direction. Just like last time, we don't have enough variables in the x direction to solve for the displacement, but we can solve for time in the y axis and then take it over to the x axis and use that to solve the problem. So I'm going to start by solving for time, and I have S, U, A, and T. So just like the previous problem, we're going to use the same equation, and when we do that, we get time is equal to 1.02 seconds. And because time is always the same in both axes, the time in the y direction is equal to the time in the x direction. So I can use that and the same equation to solve for the displacement. And when I do that, I get that the total displacement of the ball is 8.9 meters. Here's one more example. A ball is launched at 10 meters per second at a 30 degree angle, same as before, above the horizontal. What will be its velocity after 0.3 seconds? So I'm keeping the same variables that I knew before, only this time it's not coming to land. We're not analyzing the spot where it lands yet. We're analyzing a previous spot. So if I'm trying to find its velocity, that means its total velocity, not just its velocity in the x direction or the y direction. So to solve for that, I'm going to have to find each individual x and y velocity and then put them together to find the total. So I'll start in the x direction. Looking in the x direction, I have u, a, t, and I need v, so that's going to be the first equation. And when I solve for that, I get v final is equal to 8.7 meters per second, which makes sense because if the acceleration is zero, the velocity isn't changing in the x direction. And in the y direction, if I plug in my values for u, a, and t into that same equation, I get final v is equal to 2.1 meters per second. So if it moves and is in the air for 0.3 seconds, this is how fast it's going in the x direction and the y direction. So now that I have the x direction velocity and the y direction velocity of the projectile when it's been moving in the air for 0.3 seconds at that point right there, I can figure out the total velocity in this way. I know that the x velocity is this much and the y velocity is this much, and these are two individual velocity vectors. The total velocity is going to be the vector sum of the two, which means a single new vector drawn from the tail of the first to the tip of the last, which looks like this. And when I plug those into the Pythagorean theorem, because this is forming a right triangle, I find that the hypotenuse of that triangle is 8.9 meters per second. So that would be the ball's total velocity after that amount of time. So those are a few examples of solving projectile motion problems. You're going to get a lot more as the unit goes on.